It's October, and that means it's spooky game time here on episode 256 of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
So this episode, we are going to be sharing some of our current and all-time favorite horror, monsters, spooky games. That's going to be followed by a review of Side Quest Nemesis, a puzzle game from the creators of the Escape Tales series of games. And this is set in the Nemesis universe, which is very obviously inspired by one of my favorite horror series of all time, the Alien movies, or Alien and Aliens movies. Then we're going to wrap up with a review of The Marriage Mix-Up, one of the newest Holiday Hijinks games, which is actually due to the fact there's a new Kickstarter and nothing to do with horror season, though some people may make a connection there.
Before that, some introductions. I'm Sean, your host, and here with me, we have our webmaster and editor, Deanna.
Hey there to all the cardboard connoisseurs out there.
And the tabletop bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am the tabletop bellhop, your cardboard concierge, working with you to make your game nights better.
We record this podcast live Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop. And we love it when people take part and join us here in the lobby, our chat room on Twitch. This episode exists thanks to our Patreon patrons and our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com, episode 256. That's 256. Links in our show notes may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing but support us.
The Tabletop Bellhop team is here to answer your gaming and game night questions. Tonight, that question is one we answer every year in October. What are the top choices for thematic board games to play during the spooky season?
So one quick thing before we dive into our favorite creepy games, and that's the fact that October, fall, and Halloween all mean different things to different people, and not everyone in the world celebrates the same way. Now, while most people, especially in North America, deep dive into the horror element of this season, others are more about keeping things creepy cute, or spoopy seems to be the popular word for that now. Then there's also just games about the harvest and harvest season, which is also part about this time of year. And then, while some people think this entire season is a chance to dress up as your favorite sexy hot dog, or whatever case you may be. And well, I can't think of any particular games about wearing sexy costumes. Actually, prove me wrong. Let me know in the comments if there is one. The only game I can think of about dressing up is Port Pret-a-Porter, and that doesn't really fit the Halloween theme to me. But the whole point is the games we're going to be talking about tonight could fit any of those genres. We're not sticking to horror games. We're not sticking to cute games. We're not just going to talk harvesting games.
I have spotted zero sexy hot dogs in Pret-a-Porter. Yes. The point is that our list is made up of games we think fit the current creepy season in some way. Some are horror games, sure, and others are based on horror franchises, but some are just about monsters, etc. We won't be sticking to one particular Halloween aspect here, but I think any of these should fit in great at a Halloween-themed game night.
And just remember, your Halloween costume can always be sluttier. Doesn't have to be, just saying.
If you're going to throw in that, we will also add in that costume does not equal consent. Just because someone's dressed slutty doesn't make them a slut.
For us, Halloween is generally about that sort of that spooky, creepy season. Well, there is always some nice, fun, spoopy, like the Boop game of that's definitely creepy cute. For the most part, I think most of us are fans more of the horror. Maybe not necessarily slasher flicks, but some level of horror. I know I have to say I have seen more ghost faces and ghost face masks in the past month than I have ever seen in the rest of my life put together, I think. Ghost faces.
And I've still never even seen Scream, so I dig it's just the creepy thing, the goth aspect of it. I like all the spiders and skeletons and black clothes and witches and cauldrons and all that. But I have no interest in most of the horror movies or that aspect of it, especially the slashers. Like, yes, I dig the Alien films, for example, but they're more sci-fi and a lot of them are very action oriented than anything else. I'm not into the scares. I'm not a big haunted house fan. But I love all the decorations and the pumpkins and pumpkin carving and the trick or treating and the kids going out and getting candy and all those aspects of it.
Yeah, I embrace the Victorian Gothic Poe sort of Halloween. We'll go with that.
I have to say, I got a chance to visit Scare House here in Windsor for the first time last weekend, and it was fantastic. They do a wonderful job, and if you are into that sort of in-person scare, haunted house sort of thing, I can now recommend Scare House Windsor as a great destination to go to. They even do things like themed dinners, like you can have a dinners mm-hmm. in mm-hmm. the haunted house and such like that. They've got themed rooms. That was fantastic. For movie wise, for horror movies, I was always more into like Chopping Mall and The Blob, you know, not necessarily Halloween horror, but more, you know, gore, horror gore. All right. Well, with that, let's get to our list. As usual, these games are in no particular order, and we have tried to make sure these games were all games you could rush out and pick up now so that you would have them in time for your Halloween themed game night.
We've got 13 game recommendations for you because, well, 13 is spooky.
So the first one on the list for me is La Familia Hort. This is the twisted farming game that we reviewed just last week, where Granny Hortensia has died and has come back as a ghost and appeared to her grandkids during a blood moon and offered them her entire estate to the child that can best tend her gardens. This is a quick-to-learn economic farming game with a cute theme and this creepy Edward Gorey-style artwork. I think this fits this season perfectly because it gets that whole harvest season thing going on as well. You're growing gourds and pumpkins and flowers, and plus it's got that creepiness with the different characters and the blood moon veggies, I guess we'll call them. I don't even know. The special tools and things that you can grow only on a blood moon that definitely have a kind of Beetlejuicy horror aspect to them. So this one's great for people who just want to celebrate the harvest as well as people who want a little bit of creepiness for Halloween.
So I've got my first one is Box Top Pinball Haunted House from Pandasaurus. Now, this is a brand new dex-based dice-flicking pinball game. A quick game that's great for all ages with some spooky art, but it's more of in a sort of Scooby-Doo style that's not likely to be too creepy, even for your little ones. It's just three rounds of flicking fun before you total up some dice to see who won. Now, this one has got a ton of table presence as you build and set up a pinball machine and with the from the box, but it's probably going to be a little bit light for many hobby gamers. Mm-hmm. So maybe save this one for when the family comes over for some Halloween fun.
Yeah, we got to see this one first at Gamma Expo and then again at a Origins Game Fair, and it had progressed both times. Mm-hmm. And what this game really reminds me of is the classic tumbling dice, which is a gambling game where you tumble dice down like a set of wooden tiers. Really cool game you can get from Eagle Griffin Games. This is like that, but using the boxes. So it's a bunch of smaller and smaller boxes nested inside each other. You set up kind of like a stepladder, and then you flick a die and it tumbles down. Thus and there's pinball flippers and stuff on it, and there's bumpers you can knock into and all kinds of stuff. I thought there's it looked very too. Cool.
Holes you can go down. Mm-hmm. You don't get that in tumbling dice.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, there's holes you can fall down. Looks really cool. Have not gotten a chance to play it, but looks awesome. Next, we have some more new hotness for you, some more hot games, hot off the press, and that is This Game is Killer. Not that the game's name is killer, the full name of the game is This Game is Killer. This is a quick-playing party game from Smirk and Dagger based on Alien, which I know, Alien party game. Yes, that's a little odd, right? You're each playing a different crew member trapped on a ship with a xenomorph. Your only goal is to survive. And again, Alien party game. You wouldn't think these two go well together. It's a very quick card-based game where you get a couple cards and you decide what room you're in, and then it has a special effect going off. And as expected from Kurt and Smirk and Dagger, there is a ton of take that and backstabbing in this game. What I liked about this one is that despite what I just described, it's not a social deduction game. I realize it kind of sounds like that, but it's not. It's more of playing cards and seeing what happens, kind of random. You can't like lie to other people. It's a really interesting mashup of game. And like I said, it was Kurt's attempt to make a horror party game, and I honestly think it worked pretty well.
Yeah, we demoed it, and I thought it was super unique. Okay, for my next one, hear me out here. I'm thinking Zensu, but we take the wooden pieces and I stick tack little ghosts to them.
Okay. Yeah, but no. Then you can't see how they move.
All right. How about Terror Below? Another game very obviously inspired by a movie. In this case, the horror comedy Tremors. You are on a hunt for monster eggs in the Nevada desert. The problem is the monsters are attracted by sound, and the faster you go, the more noise you make. It's this really neat thematic game that successfully captures the campy feel of the movie. I wondered if I could squeak this into the list or not, because I think it's technically out of print, but it is still available on Amazon. So,
and this has some amusing homages to the movie, like losing your hat is a big deal in the game. And there's actually a part where you can jump your pickup truck over a giant chasm. And it's very chaotic, but fun. Next is I don't know if it's my first. I can't remember if I have another on the list, but a series of games, and that being the Horrified games. The first being my favorite, and the first being the Universal Monsters version of Horrified. They, you know, feature Dracula and Frankenstein and the Creature from the Black Lagoon, all based on the classic Universal Studios monsters. Since that came out, there is now American Monsters featuring like cryptids like the Mothman. There's Greece Monsters featuring, you know, the Minotaur and other creatures from ancient myths. And there's a new one that came out only recently, and that is Horrified World of Monsters. And this one has monsters from all over the world, as you'd expect from the names. You've got like the Sphinx, the Yeti, the Yangtze of China. And of course, you can't have a horror game without the great old one himself, Cthulhu. Now, what's really cool about these games and what I love about them is the fact each monster plays different. Like one of them, you might have to collect weapons and then go battle. And then another one, you might have to solve some type of puzzle. And then another one might be moving to certain areas to lure them somewhere. And like everyone plays different. And then you play with more than one of these at once, which just gives you such a wide variety of possibilities. And you can scale the difficulty. If you're playing with kids, just throw one monster out there. It's going to be easy, but the kid's going to have fun. You want to challenge yourself, put in more than four. The game only recommends four. We tried five. Yeah, we didn't win that game.
All right, well, my next one is Psychobabble. Now, this one was new last year, and we had to keep it on the list because we continue to enjoy this fascinating social deduction game. Still one of the best we've all played. And I can't remember the last big event that we held that it didn't get played at least once. One player is a psychoanalyst, and everyone else is an inmate in the asylum. They all have had the same shared dream, except one who is actually mentally unstable. Dreams are represented by fantastical, whimsical art cards. The analyst is trying to guess which card represents the shared dream. The sane inmates are trying to deduce which of them is insane, and the insane one wants to be lumped in with the sane and just be one of the group. The key trick, though, is that the inmates don't know which among them is actually the insane one. You have to see this game played to really get how brilliant it is, even if some of the terms used aren't necessarily the most politically correct.
Next, I have The Night Cage. This is a cooperative tile-laying game where each of the players is lost in an ever-changing maze. It's up to you as a group to each find your own key, then find each other, and then all escape through a gate while keeping your candles lit and trying to avoid horrific monsters like the Wax Eaters. What I think makes this game stand out are actual feelings of isolation, panic, and hopelessness that can come out while playing. It's not often you find a horror game that actually invokes feelings of horror from the players. Now, this was on our list last year, but I wanted to put it on because since we last talked about this one, there has been an expansion released called The Shrieking Hollow, which introduces a new threat and a new space to explore. Now, when you fall down a pit, you end up in the hollow where the other lies in wait.
Yeah, I honestly feel like this is the only other game besides Nyctophobia that manages to really evoke those feelings of fear and stuff. And Nyctophobia is not on the list because it's very out of print. But next up, I've got Monstrosity, which is a drawing-based party game where one player has just spotted a monster, but they only caught a glimpse of it, and now they have to describe it to the other players from memory. The other players play as sketch artists who have to draw the monster that the first player is describing. I mean, drawing pictures of monsters. How perfect is that for a Halloween theme? I have to say some of the cards in the base set are rather creepy, which is why we go with the cute creatures or robots expansions when we play with the kids. Your mileage may vary.
Now, if you want something else that's more on that cute, silly, spooky side of things, there is Scooby-Doo Escape from the Haunted Mansion. Now, this did make our list last year, but I wanted to put it back on because our family loves playing escape room games together. Excuse me. Because our family loves playing escape room games together. We just played one on Thanksgiving, but our favorite by far of all the ones we've ever played is this Scooby-Doo themed game. It's from the op, and it's part of the Coded Chronicles series, which uses this brilliant system where every player is playing different characters, and you end up interacting, using a character to interact with something in the environment, which gives you a code that you look up in the book, and then you read it, and it's from that character's perspective. It almost gives like a role-playing feel to it, though it's not as open as an RPG where you can do anything, but it's definitely an interactive story, I would say, like a Which Way book kind of thing going on, and it is just a fantastic system. Now, the Scooby's silliness is in full effect here. Our kid's favorite thing to do in the game was to have Shaggy try to eat everything in the game. And yes, the game accounted for that and had an answer for every different thing you wanted Shaggy to eat. Now, the one thing you do have to be aware of with this game, and this is the biggest downfall of the Coded Chronicles series, is these games are one and done. Once you played it once, it's pretty much done, but you don't have to destroy anything while playing this game, so you can easily pass it on to another family to enjoy.
So yes, I adore Scooby-Doo Escape from the Haunted Mansion. It's one of the most fun experiences we've ever had playing games as a family. But as Mo said, it's a one and done. So I have to call out one more escape room style game, and that is Dimensions from Mysterious Package Company. The game revolves around a 2-foot-tall pop-up haunted house. It also comes with a very elaborate scrapbook that guides you through the 5 chapters of the game. This creepy paper dollhouse is so neat, with all these little details like furniture and cupboards that open up. It's super cool. The game would be so perfect for a spooky-themed game night, with 2 caveats. One, because you're all trying to cram around a giant paper dollhouse to find the clues. Playing with 2 or 3 is a sweet spot. 4 is possible. Anything more than that is just not fun. Mm. And number 2, the game is long. The box promises 5 to 10 hours of gameplay, so you probably aren't finishing this in one sitting.
Yeah, that's not one you're going to want to break out. You might want to start it on Halloween night, but that you're getting a week's worth of gameplay here out of that one. And I got to say, one of the best aspects, like you mentioned, is the fact that like you can open all the cupboards. That was one of those things I didn't realize till we got it. And then like, oh my gosh, all these doors open. And the thing is just cool.
The toilet seat lifts up.
Yeah, the toilet seat lifts up. There was a clue under the toilet seat, if I remember. Slight spoiler. And the other thing that, like, I've seen a lot of people showing off this game. We've shown it off. We have an unboxing. Check out our unboxing. But the big thing you don't tend to see is the scrapbook. The scrapbook is so cool. Like, yeah, the dollhouse, 3-foot-tall dollhouse is pretty awesome. But you also get this, like, fully detailed scrapbook with stuff that comes out and photos and stuff tucked in and under. And it's just so well produced.
Every bit as elaborate as the dollhouse. The scrapbook blew me away, and I did not expect that.
All right, well, the next one, a game I have, is something we're really happy that we could put back on this list after having to leave it in the honorable mentions for a while. And that is Ghost Fight and Treasure Hunters. Now, back in print with the new anniversary edition that looks like it changes up a couple of things. Now, the core gameplay is the same game that we have loved for years and have gone on and on about. It is a cooperative action grab game that has players trying to get the gems out of the house. That also involves some ghost busting, as you can't let the place be overrun by ghosts. The big new feature that the anniversary edition adds is the ability to play it as a 1-verse mini game where one player controls the ghosts.
Yes, competitive Ghost Fight and Treasure Hunters is now a thing. Now, speaking of new content for older games, I'm going to toss in Sorcerer from Wise Wizard Games. Now, Sorcerer is one of the best 2-player dueling card games out there. I know everyone's trying to outdo Magic, everyone's trying to make a new version, but you know what? Deanna and I really enjoyed this one. This one really caught my interest with some of the interesting things going on. Like you just automatically rolled randomly to generate how much mana you got every round, and you could do things to reroll the dice, and combat was dice-based, and it just, I don't know, it was a lot more interesting. Now, the thing is, they also had a really unique way of doing deck building, non-collectible. You're going to take 3 different decks, your character, your lineage, and domain, and mash them together. And sure enough, Wise Wizard has released multiple different character, lineage, and domain decks. And then you're playing a battle to control 2 out of 3 locations with your usual stuff, right? You're going to summon monsters, you're going to put on equipment and buffs and battle each other and roll dice and everything else. Now, our main complaint when we reviewed the game was the creepy, horrific artwork and themes. Like, there is someone who plays diseases and bugs, and it's just really gross. And it's just kind of over the top. And I was like, you know, I would love to play this game with our kids. But at the time, they weren't old enough to really deal with this. Like, they were creeped out by the artwork. But honestly, when we're talking about horror games, this fits perfectly now. But the big thing that I wanted to bring this back up and bring Sorcerer back to people's attention is Endbringer. This is a new box set, the same size as the original. It is an expansion. It is not standalone. That includes 1 to 3 player cooperative play. So now you're going to mash up your deck. You're also going to create an adversary. Now, the adversary is also made up of 3 different decks. So you still got that cool deck mashing going on. And you're going to play cooperatively to try to defeat the Endbringer, this adversary. Now, this expansion is just hitting stores now. So this is, again, some new hotness from us.
And on top of that, there are actually 23 other decks of cards that you can bring into the game to mash in of the different sorts. They have really put a lot into this game, and some of these are just brand new. Like, the game was released in 2019, and in 2024 there are like 6 new decks that have come out.
Still going strong. And I gotta say, Endbringer looks super interesting. Next up,
Deanna said the co-op version looks super interesting. You got to stop saying you don't like co-op games.
I'm curious about it. I want to be tormented so I can tell you all I hate it.
There you go.
All right. The Deadlies. All right. That's what I've got next. I mean, the Halloween's all about evil, right? And the 7 deadly sins are evil. All right. This may be a bit of a stretch, but we love this game. Similar to Psychobabble, this is another game that we brought home from a con. And we started playing it and showed it to our friends and family and other local gamers, and people cannot get enough of it. This is now a staple for our monthly game nights. It's like Uno for gamers. It's a hand-shedding game with 7 suits for the 7 deadly sins, where each suit has its own special rules when played. Things like Wrath making your opponents draw cards, Envy letting you swap hands, etc. We can't recommend this game enough. It works both for a family game night, a casual game night, or an adult beverage-filled party.
I'm going to call it one amusing thing about this. So every episode, for those who haven't joined us live, haven't seen this, we set up a Kallax behind me and we put the games we're talking about back there. So behind us, we've got all the games we're talking about tonight and these horror games on the list. And Gwen often helps us out, my oldest daughter, to collect the games. And we're like, can you grab the Deadlies? And she's like, the Deadlies? Does the Deadlies fit? You're doing horror games, right? So
is we that had a Halloween game? Like,
there's Wrath and Envy and 7 Deadly Sins gets that Lust is one of them. So there we have our game about sexy costumes now included on the list. So I just thought it was funny that Gwen called us out before the episode started.
All right. Well, now we have our honorable mentions, games which slipped off of our main list for one reason or another.
So it's just you. You're alone on a cold and gloomy night. Maybe the kids are out trick-or-treating and you're handing out candy, or you live on a cul-de-sac and no one actually comes to your house. From what I am told, we haven't tried it ourselves, a great way to spend your time on a cold and gloomy night on your own is to play one of the many Final Girl scenarios. Now, there are a ton of these out, each pitting you, the star, against a different trope-filled horror adventure. Pretty much all of your popular horror movies are represented here. I'm not sure if any of them are licensed, but they're definitely, you can kind of tell. You know, there's the Alone at the Lake, but the camp, you know, and there's this In the House and William Shatner's chasing you or whatever. I've heard great things about the Final Girls. Unfortunately, I am not a big horror fan, nor am I a big solo gamer. So it's not a series I've tried, but I have heard really good things about this one.
And there are about 20 different scenarios you can do now for Final Girl after their most recent release of a season.
Okay, somewhat along the same lines, how about Arkham Horror, the card game? Yes, this ends up as an honorable mention every time we talk Halloween games, and no, we still haven't tried it. I'm mentioning it now to save time so we don't get called out for not calling it out. I know people do consider this also to be one of the best solo games of all times. So if that's your jam, check it out.
And that does play more than one, but it seems like most people seem to prefer that solo. All right. So back in the day, again, when I was talking about how I don't really like horror movies, right? But I would still always put on the WXON TV 20 Detroit creature double feature at noon on Saturdays and pray to the gods that it was going to be a giant monster movie instead of some werewolf, hammer, film, vampire, whatever. And I loved watching stuff like Godzilla and Ultraman and Jet Jaguar. Now, the best ones, though, was the crossovers when you got them all together on Monster Island. So I want to toss in another game I think would be great for family game night, and that is the King of Monster Island. Now, what this is part of the King of series of games, King of Tokyo, King of New York, but this is a cooperative version where players team up to defeat a Titan level boss. Now, one warning, despite being a King of game, this is not compatible with the other games. This is 100% standalone, big coffin box game, a big epic game of its own. Now, I have heard people that like to swap out the standees to play their favorite monsters, but like the cards and the dice, the whole mechanics don't work together.
All right. Well, unfortunately, it is not really available right now, which is why this is in our honorable mentions. D mentioned it earlier, but Nyctophobia, if you can get your hands on it, is a great choice for Halloween because you're running literally blind to escape from an axe murderer or trying to rescue your friend from a vampire, depending on which version of the game you have. This is one of the most unique mechanisms out there, as all but one player is literally blindfolded while playing.
Yeah, it comes with the best blackout sunglasses I've ever seen. I don't understand how they work so well. They're just sunglasses. Like, it's not a full blindfold. Just you put on these sunglasses and man, they work. And one fair warning, and this is something, you know, session zero, before you start playing this game, you have to be comfortable with someone else touching you to play this game. That is the one complaint I've heard about this game and have heard people calling it the most horrific game ever made because I have to let strangers touch me to play it. Note, they're only touching your hand. They're going to guide your hand to touch the board. But it is worth noting that some people do have a problem with that, which is something, you know what, I never even considered. I had no problem with it. But I have seen that called out on other podcasts, other shows, and one review that was like, this is the most horror. Of course, leading up to this episode, I've been listening to other people's top horror lists. Well, to some people, that's the most horrifying game out there because someone else has to touch you.
I could see that at public play events. That could make you uncomfortable. I mean, we're playing with our family. That's a different bag entirely. All right. One of the more popular horror-themed games here in Windsor lately is Blood on the Clock Tower. There was a group that came out to play at one of our brewery game nights, and from what I've heard, that's grown into a sizable group that is now getting together to play every couple of weeks. They're supposed to be at our next event again on coming up on the 24th as well. Unfortunately, I'm always busy teaching and hosting, so I haven't gotten to try it myself, but the people who are into it are loving it. Mm-hmm. To me, it seems to be a social deduction game along the lines of Werewolf, but taken to an extreme level with way more going on, a lot more story involved. It's not about picking favorites the person you like least to eliminate, as much as getting into your role and interacting with the other players. And it also features campaign-style play, and rewards playing with the same group over and over. So, the entire thing just fascinates me.
Yeah, it looks fascinating watching groups get into it. Like, there's definitely like a whole, something's presented, then everyone breaks off into little groups and chats with each other and then come back and do a thing. And kind of reminds me a bit of like the classic game Diplomacy. There's some of that going on there. The whole campaign thing is you're trying to figure out who the demon is. And like, some people are evil and some are good and you don't know. And there's some roles that are mixed. And when one of the local gamers, Ross, brought this out, he's got this like giant box he's carrying around like on a platter while he's playing and moving chips around. It looks extremely involved and looks extremely awesome. And we need him to do another intro night. So if anyone's in the Windsor Detroit area on the 24th, they are going to be having a beginner friendly, like you don't have to have played, you don't have to be part of a campaign to try it at the Walkerville Brewery. So if you can make it out, this is your chance.
All right, well, there you have our list of great spooky board game suggestions. We're going to stop now in the lobby to see what they have to add. There's been a few suggestions in there. First off, from Charlie Brown, he asks, is there a board game out there where you play kids and go out trick-or-treating, perhaps while avoiding thugs to steal your loot?
Oh, what is it called? MV Board Games. Isn't that a trick-or-treat game?
I don't know.
The candy one?
The one I found.
13 candies?
Is that not 16 candies? Maybe it's not about trick or treat, but I thought it was. Fast paced, sweet game, each round, draw and discard cards, different types of candy, trying to form the best hand. They say, I got candy. Okay, there's no actual Halloween theme.
All right.
So I found one. It actually fulfilled on Kickstarter back October 2023. But there is a link there. I haven't tried it. See whether or not you can pre-order it. Yes. So at Castle Clark, castleclark.net, it's Haunted Halloween, the trick or treat game. That's, but I can't speak for it. I just know it was out there and has some fun Kickstarter-y type stuff with candy tokens and giant candy corn piece holders and things. But again, I've never played that game. That's the only one I could come across quickly.
I feel like there's a lunch money retheme begging to be made here.
I'd be surprised if there isn't one. I haven't heard about that game in a long time. The Pumpkin Problem, one of the Holiday Hijinks games, is about the candy, Halloween candy going missing and having to find it, but you're not specifically a trick-or-treater. I think you're a parent who's going to give out candies and that, but that is the theme of that one. That's probably the closest I've got. That might need some research. Instead of Halloween-themed games, but like Halloween-themed games. Like not horror or whatever, but like literally
Halloween.
Halloween-themed games.
And I tried to do a quick Google, but unfortunately, due to the terms, finding a board game about dressing up in costumes for Halloween is really, really hard because there are a lot of board game costumes that exist. Yes. And so trying to narrow down the search terms is proving a little tough to do on the fly. So that might have to wait till later.
So I will point out there are, I can't count the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, about 20? No. There are at least 25 games on Board Game Geek that have Halloween in the title. Many just called Halloween. There's a 2017, a 2023, a 2022, a 2012, a 24. Halloween Party, Halloween Dice, Halloween to the Game. Well, we know that's based on the horror. Halloween Lies, Halloween Party Memento Mori. There's a ton. Halloween Hustle.
Yeah. And like there is and a game called Trick or Treat, but it's actually just like a Rum Ginny game. Rum game.
That's right. What I was about to say. Well, I went down a different search rabbit game. Hole. I went down a different search rabbit hole, and I can tell you there are a bunch of Trick or Treat card games out there.
Yeah.
But I mean, we're just Googling and telling you about it live. How exciting is that? What else we got?
All right. They also mentioned, Charlie Brown also mentions When Darkness Comes, which they're playing through right now.
That is not one I know off the top of my head. So.
And the Arkham.
Is that Twilight Creations there? All right. So that's a Twilight Creations game. Twilight Creations makes a ton of horror themed games. I don't know if they're still around. Like they're old. Like this When Darkness Comes. Came out in 2002 and has like 9 expansions, but stopped being in print in 2005. So Twilight Creations was the company often known for taking pictures of real people for their stuff. They're the people behind the Zombies game with 3 exclamation marks and a number of other well-known horror games. Not seeing anything. 2019 is the newest game I see from that publisher, but I do know they put out a ton of games with that theme. My favorite was Brains, which I don't tell you exactly how to spell, but that was like a quick brain. Sorry, I just found it. Brains from 2006 was one of my favorite games from them, with little tiny brain tokens. But it was just a silly pusher luck dice game where you collected brains and whoever had the most brains at the end won.
And while Charlie Brown calls out Zombicide Black Plague as being a scary one, realistically, any zombie games are perfectly acceptable for the spooky season.
Yeah, I don't know what the latest Zombicide version is. I do know they put out a Zombicide version 2, like part 2. And Marvel? They did Marvel Zombie. Yeah, but I don't think that's the most recent. I think the most recent is an Old West version of Zombicide. Mm-hmm. But yes, the Zombicide games are neat. We have played a smattering of them. I played Invader. We played Black Plague. I enjoyed Black Plague. I've played the original. I haven't yet to try the second edition. I've heard it's better, but I haven't played it myself. And with that, I think we will wrap up and move on.
Thank you so much for the suggestions, Lobby. What about those of you watching or listening at home? What games are on your Halloween game night list? Let me know by leaving a comment, sending an email to Deanna at tabletopbellhop.com or start up a conversation on our Discord server.
And now a message from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
The Holiday Hijinks Master Detective Collection Kickstarter is live and already funded.
Now, we told you before about how this Kickstarter includes three new 18-card escape room games, The Leprechaun Larceny, The New Year Nightmare, and The Krampus Caper, as well as a big box to hold them all and a way to purchase the complete collection.
What we didn't know is that the all-in pledge works out to be about 50% off the retail price of buying these games. So this is a great way to get some puzzle games at a great price.
Now, the other thing Mark has announced on social media and all over the place and in his newsletters is what he is calling the Hijinks Hunt. This is a backer-only puzzle adventure that's actually part of the current Kickstarter. A puzzle in the Kickstarter about puzzle games. I think it's pretty clever. Now, as you know, we really enjoy these small pack card games. We just played one the other day, the Marriage Mix-Up. We did that on Canadian Thanksgiving and had a great time. Now, this particular one did this cool thing where you actually split into two teams and you got to work on your puzzles together, but each of you only has incomplete information. So the only way to solve it is to work with the other team. And I love that because it really showcased how important clear communication can be, which I thought tied well to the theme of a marriage game.
Yeah, it was super cool. I've got one last thing before we move on. Well, a new Kickstarter is always exciting. Don't forget that you can always save an extra 10% off on all Grand Gamers Guild existing games over on their website with code BELLHOP, BELLHOP.
A merch announcement.
So we got a round of samples for our new merch store at Fourth Wall, and overall, we were extremely pleased. Shirts look awesome, and the mugs, even better.
Things weren't perfect, though, and because of that, we've made some tweaks. Some are small, like we removed a bunch of the darker shirts that had dark text and instead have gone with more contrasting colors. A big one, though, is that we now offer women's versions of the shirts. I got shirts for myself and our daughter, Gwen, and we found that they were far too long. Like, they're great if you tuck them in, but they're really odd if you don't. Like, I think Gwen's was almost knee length on her. We could have put a belt around it and called it a dress. So we then discovered that the women's shirts are 3 to 4 inches shorter, so we've added those to the store.
We also eliminated these stickers, as they were much smaller than we expected, and they really didn't seem worth any of the pricing options we were given.
Yeah, unfortunately, like there's a range we're allowed to set the prices, and we were kind of stuck with what they did, and what we saw was not impressive. Finally, there's the mugs, right? So I got myself one of the big white 20-ounce mugs, and it looks great. I love the look of it. But it's a bit much. I run the large cup on my Keurig twice and I could still fit more in here. So I figured it was just a little excessive. Now, we do still offer this for those of you who want gigantic mugs. But what we did is decide to offer this graphic on the two-tone, two-color mugs, which are still quite large. They are actually the size of the mugs you see us usually holding up, with the black and white and the Bellhop logo on it. And for those of you watching on video, it's what Sean and Deanna are holding up right now. So you can now get this on a slightly more reasonably sized mug, but we fully get it. If you want this size, it exists. You can still have it.
So yeah, it's available as soup bowl or like this, which is, I think, 15 ounces, which I find to be just perfect. You can check out the revised store over at tabletopbellhop.com/merch.
Now, before we move on, I also want to thank whoever deserves it, at Board Game Geek, for featuring our YouTube channel, not just the one day, this week, it seems like. None of us had any idea this was going to happen, and we only learned about it due to one of our Patreon patrons. So thank you, Jeff, for the heads up, and thank you, Board Game Geek, for featuring us this week. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah, thanks so much for letting us know about that, Jeff. It might have just slipped under the radar. So I've got one more. Next week, we're going to be recording a special episode interviewing Mark from Grand Gamers Guild. So I thought I'd tell you all about that ahead of time so you can consider stopping in to catch us live next Wednesday.
So yeah, next Wednesday, that is on October the 23rd, we are going to be recording our first ever sponsor AMA. You can talk to the owner, CEO, I don't know if they're incorporated, the owner of Grand Gamers Guild, Mark Spector himself. You can talk to him and his ghost Khonshu.
Yeah, we're saying interview, but it's going to be an AMA. It's going to be show up and ask Mark anything. So it'll be interesting.
Your crew has been offered the opportunity of a lifetime from the corporation. A ship carrying some high-end cargo vanished. You just need to find the ship and bring it back to Earth. Easy money.
That's the setup for Side Quest Nemesis, an escape room in a box from the designers of the Escape Tales series and published originally by a company called Lock Me. It was localized for North America this year by Board and Dice, who were giving away copies at Gamma Expo, which is where our copy came from.
This puzzle game is listed as good for 1 to 4 players and has a longer playing time listed than expected for most escape room in a box games, noting that it'll take 1 to 1.5 hours. Side Quest is a series of games, with Nemesis just being one of the games in the series.
The game comes in a small box that becomes part of the puzzle. Part of these Side Quest games is the fact that you build a small room out of the box. You also get a number of punch boards and thick cardboard tokens, a large deck of cards, some fold-out sheets, and an answer matrix. There's a lot of stuff in a small box, a lot more than we're used to seeing in escape room games.
Yeah, there's a lot of board game overlap here. It feels much more than just, you know, a card game or compared to other escape room games we have. It's that there's a lot more components. Now, Side Quest Nemesis is tied to the board game Nemesis, which I think most listeners will be aware of. It's one of the most popular games out there, which is itself an aliens game with the serial numbers barely piled off, to be honest. This escape room game is promoted to be what it says, right? It's a side quest. That's the whole point of this, is here's another Nemesis story. So you know the game, you played the game, you played the campaign. Well, here's another story in the same universe. And I got to say, that is an awesome concept, especially because it involves multiple different publishers putting out different types of games, all for the same license. Which, yes, you often see that for like Star Wars, but not that kind of collaboration for a board game license. And I think that's awesome.
Yeah, that's pretty neat. You don't need to know anything about the Nemesis license to play, thankfully, because I don't have a clue. This is a completely standalone game, though familiarity with the whole hidden alien on a spaceship genre will give you a bit of help with some of the puzzles.
Now, to play Side Quest Nemesis, you have to go through a bit of setup, which involves building the box room thing, laying out some cards representing the ship interior, putting together a standee. There are 2 decks of cards. You have to shuffle an infection deck and an encounter deck. And then there's the main deck, which you'll be drawing from as you progress through the game.
So the first puzzle you have in the game, the once you actually start playing, because the setup's like 5 cards worth of stuff you have to go through. And I actually set up the game before we sat down to play, and it took more time than I'm used to. Again, this escape room game has a lot of board game elements that way. Like, you literally had a board you set up, and you had a player sheet and a little token to track what the oxygen level is. No, it wasn't oxygen. There was something we kept. There was a little cardboard tracker.
Life support.
Yes, it was the level of the life support in the ship. Like, there's all this interesting things going on. But what it does do when you first start is it introduces you to the game system, which is a system where you're going to need to find 4 things. So the answer to most puzzles requires 4 things. And that could be 4 colors, 4 numbers, or 4 symbols. And there are tokens that match these, and they're different rectangles of different lengths. That's about the best way I can describe them without showing to you. And then once you find your 4 things, you put them on this grid, which is called the answer matrix. So you're putting these tokens on the grid, and then once you've got your 4 things, you check to see if you were right. And if the symbols match on this grid, you're right. You're like, okay, the symbols on the left match, symbol on the right, we have the right answer. Then it'll point you to the next card to draw. So it's a very unique mechanic I've never seen before in an escape room game. And I loved how tactile it was. I liked how you were touching things, manipulating things. And I just found that way more interesting and intriguing than flip the card 54. And if it's not, go to the next card, you're wrong, which is what we've seen in some other games.
I liked it better than code wheels that we've done in other games. Felt simpler and less likely we were going to physically mess it up. So one of the coolest things in this escape room experience is the freedom you have to explore. You're going to be moving around the ship by moving your standee and flipping over cards. Like Mo said, it's almost a board game layout of rooms that you move through. As you flip each one over, you then have a random encounter. And then once you're through that, you then interact with the room.
There are a wide variety of puzzle types, including logic puzzles, deduction, pattern recognition, and more. Some puzzles are right on the cards, others will require various cardboard bits on the punch boards, and others will require you to interact with the room you made out of the box.
Now, most of the puzzles do need that 4-digit code, but they've also thrown in other things where it'll be like you'll draw an encounter card and it'll be like, this terrible thing's happening, what do you do? And you have to then deduce the answer, and then look it up, like check page 28 of the, or not page, but like number 28 in the code book. And that just felt very open. Like you, it took that, you weren't just looking for four things and four colors and four numbers. Instead, I'm like, I've got a xenomorph rushing at me. What do I do? And I have to use the information on the card to figure that out. And I thought that was fascinating, that the entire game wasn't just put stuff in a code wheel, look up stuff on the answer matrix. There was more to it than that.
Right? Like, I don't want to spoil. So I'm going to say it was like, you could literally go, I don't know, Mo, what do you think we should do? Drop a rock on it? Yes. Let's drop a rock on it. And then we look at the card and it goes, it agrees with us. That is what we were supposed to do. Excellent. And it was neat that there was this, you know, out of the box thing, not just the always get four symbols. And it made it more immersive than having an alien is chasing you. Now stop and find four symbols before you continue. Yes,
that's true. No, that's a very good point about it. Because a lot of those escape room games, it's like, stop telling the story so I can solve the puzzle so I can tell more story. No, this all felt like it was part of the game. You're like, I open up a panel, things broken, figure out how to fix it. You know, there's this thing rushing at you. Like, again, you know what the tropes are going to be. If you've ever seen an alien movie, you kind of know what some of the stuff's going to be.
Say the Lord of the Rings, that's exit game, which also had an IP tied to it. I found the thematic tie-ins there were terrible. There was nothing tying it in thematically to the stop, do a puzzle. These all felt very thematically tied in.
Fair enough.
One thing,
and I got to say, the puzzles here were very clear and clever, and I love that answer matrix thing. I thought it was more interesting than the other series we played. And what I don't know is if that answer matrix is unique to all side quest games. I kind of hope it is, because I think it's a brilliant mechanic for figuring out if you have the right answer and if you're progressing well.
Yeah, I adored it. I do hope that that is their mechanic.
Now, the game does also present a hint system, and it is graduated hints. So your first hint is look up the letter that's on your current puzzle, and it gives you that very basic, do you have the right things that are available? Now, another thing I liked is on the cards themselves, they told you how many cards were required to solve the current puzzle. So anytime it just said one, you had everything you needed. If it said two, you needed two cards. If it said three, you needed three cards. So that was a nice touch. And then even when you're going through the graduated hint system, it's like, okay, the first thing you need to do is decipher the thing. And you're like, well, yeah, okay, decipher the thing. I figured that out. Next thing it says is you're going to have to look at the numbers. And I'm making this up off the top of my head. You're like, okay, yeah, I'm looking at the numbers. Oh, did you know the numbers can overlap? And you're like, oh, okay. But like you had to go three hints in before you got to that. And I like that because some groups are going to sit there and go, oh, wait, yeah, okay, I need that extra thing. Or, oh, it's about the numbers. I was totally looking at the back of the card and the art. And it ends up I'm supposed to be looking for numbers. So I did really appreciate the staggered clue system in this. It was very well done. And you're flipping enough through, like, it's only like a four panel thing. It wasn't a huge book to flip through, but everything's staggered. So it's not hard. You don't have that problem where you accidentally read something you don't want to.
Yes, I really liked the way that hint book was laid out. Instead of, say, the card system that they have in Exit, which also keeps you from looking at things when you don't mean to, but you got to go fish through and find card X. This was like, hints level one on this page, hints level two back here, level three is inside, level four is on that page.
Yeah.
If you're not trying to see anything, you don't have a problem. Also, we originally were worried about leaving a hint book on the table and that we might see something we didn't want to see, but the ones on that front are the most simple. It's like, yeah, you're going to have four colors in this. I'm like, yes, that is very obvious. Thank you. They were the most simple, most obvious stuff on the front page. So you couldn't spoil anything by looking over at it by mistake.
Now, one thing you will not find in this game is a score system or ranking at the end or even time limit. Now, the box said 90 to 150 or an hour to an hour and a half. And our game took a bit over an hour and a half. I think we're, 139 minutes or something like that, I think you said?
132,
so just over an hour and a half. But unlike some of these games, like the Holiday Hijinks games from our sponsor, you don't get a ranking at the end. So there's no penalty for looking at the hints, except for you now know you looked up a hint. And like many of these games, I do recommend if you do get stuck, it's way better to look up those hints than get frustrated, especially with the graduated hint system where you're probably not going to have to turn to the page which gives you the solution. At least we didn't have to.
One really interesting thing I found about this is that much like the Nemesis game itself, there are expansions. So while Nemesis, people understand that Nemesis has a lot of different versions and expansions, and there's so much content out there for the Nemesis world to enjoy. Well, there's a promo pack you can get for the Nemesis side quest as well, and you can add on another puzzle.
Oh, that's neat.
It makes a new room. I was looking at that. So I do want to extrapolate a bit on the room thing. What I thought was neat is basically you take the box and you put the two edges on it. And they tease you with that because it kind of sits out on the table for a while and you don't interact with it. But eventually you will actually modify it, I think, is the best way to do it. You're going to solve puzzles and then add to that room and then eventually have to use it. And then there was a port where it was like you opened a door and you literally took a side off and now had a new puzzle. There was a thing with the floor. It was just very... The entire system, this entire game was very physical. It felt more like an escape room. We were manipulating things. You were moving things. Like even just the exploring the ship was moving a standee to different rooms and flipping them over and then having a random encounter. No, random. This is not fully scripted. You had a deck of cards of encounters and you'd flip over a random encounter and have it happen. The other thing that was really impressive by this is there were four different endings you could get, depending on the actions you took during the game. Mm-hmm. And some of that was randomly generated. And I don't want to spoil anything, but realize this is an alien game and things can happen when you run into aliens.
I will say there was also at least one point in the game where we got to make a choice, just a straight up choice that was not whether or not we solved the puzzle, and that affected the outcome of the story at the end. So that was neat too, that there was a branching story decision. And all of the endings were very, very story driven. They were very much, you know, there was, I think, four in total different endings, and they were very story driven. So that was neat too. Also, they could have just handed us a sheet that had all these weird shapes on them and told us to fit these shapes into this puzzle. And instead, you got physical counters that you punched out of a punch board. Everything is totally reusable. There is nothing in this game that you're going to punch. Well, you punch it out from the punch boards, but there's nothing that you're going to cut, mutilate, whatever. So as long as you label the stuff so someone knows it came from X punch board, because the punch boards have descriptive titles. Like I said, not A, B, or C, but storage locker, and this is what was in the storage locker. As long as you label your plastic bags that you shove them all in at the end, this is very much a game that you can pass on to someone else, so that's cool too.
Yeah, I was trying to decide how to pack this up because we can send this to someone else. Honestly, I want Sean to try this one because I think it was really cool. But I'm thinking I'm possibly trying to push the stuff back into the punch board and then maybe put it in the shrink wrap. There was one little, really minor thing. What I couldn't find in the rules is if you should have took the box insert out. So it had a cardboard trough-like insert to hold the cards. And you do build a floor. Well, we did our floor on top of the insert. And all I have to say is it didn't matter. So I don't think it would have mattered if you left the insert in or took it out. But that could have been a little bit more clear in the instructions.
Two things. It definitely didn't break the game the way we did it. And because at some point in the game we had to fish that out, I think it was easier to fish out because you had it elevated a bit.
Yes.
And the graphics sort of worked that way. So I think we did it the right way.
I think so. It was hard to always. It was the only thing where I'm like, I almost wanted to go to Board Game Geek. Like, do I take this out? This is before we started, right? It was the setup was five cards. I said during setup, I'm like, am I supposed to take that out or not? And it wasn't clear. Overall, I am extremely impressed by the first side quest game we played, again, based on the Nemesis. I have a feeling those four endings may mean something to someone who's played Nemesis. I don't know, but I'm wondering if we played a prequel to one of the stories. I don't know. I haven't played Nemesis.
There was a named character that I assume you would know who the heck that is if you were into the IP.
I don't know. It felt like this could have been the intro to a game. I don't know if that's true or not. But this was the most tactile escape room experience. Escape room experience we played. We have played some murder mystery games that had more stuff and more stuff you could interact with. But those were like large chests and pocket watches and drinking flasks. This was a very board gamey tokens, counters, physically manipulating things to make them fit, moving things on a hex map. Like there was a lot more board gameiness to this than any other escape room game I played. And kind of like fourth edition D&D and its ties to board gaming, I loved it. I thought it was awesome. I really enjoyed the physicality of this side quest game.
I'm going to call out the only downside I saw to this game is that we played it with two players. And I definitely wouldn't want to play it with more. The quests were not splittable. We had to go, I'm looking at the card. I'm done looking at the card. I haven't figured it out. You look at the card. Or I've already figured it out. Just look at it and see if you agree with me. And, you know, maybe if I got stumped, we'd pass it back and forth. And we kind of took turns reading them first. But there was no way to split the tasks or be simultaneously working on the same puzzle. Though the ones that had pieces to manipulate were mostly better. There was one that was very much about perspective and only one person could be doing it because you had to be holding everything at the right angle to be able to do it, right? So as a solo game, it would probably be a blast. As a two-player game, it's enjoyable because you got two brains. Three, maybe. Beyond that, I think heck no.
Yeah, I'm on the fence about that just because there was one physical puzzle where you were manipulating things and I reached across the table and moved a bit, right? Like, so some of it, you definitely could interact more. More so than some other games we played. Mm-hmm. But I think you need two brains. I think two people is probably the sweet spot for here. But mm-hmm. I agree, four would be a bit much. You would probably have to fight over who gets to do what, take turns drawing cards. I'm actually honestly glad we didn't play with the kids for that reason.
Yeah.
Because especially with the small pieces, they would have all wanted to do the thing.
Oh, and I will say some of the art's pretty creepy. So for younger kids, I would say no. There's some pretty creepy art.
It is,
and you might want a magnifying glass.
It is very much recommended. 83% best at two. Yeah. Not mm-hmm. recommended for three, four, or more than four.
I can see solo. It's just that two brains, right? Like there was definitely like the puzzle. You got stuck in the one puzzle until I manipulated one thing. Mm-hmm. There was one I was completely stuck on. And this is what happens when we're not scripted. Another thing I will point in is be careful with putting things on the answer matrix. It's a little fiddlier than looking up stuff on a wheel or flipping to the right card. And if you're lining stuff up, say, to the wrong letter, you're going to find the puzzle impossible to solve until you realize you're lining up stuff on the wrong letter. So we did use the hints to find the solution to one of the puzzles.
Which and it ends up we had the we right had solution. At.
And I'm like, oh, is there a misprint here? Is something wrong on the answer matrix? Mm-hmm. Oh, no, we were just lined up wrong. So there was a little bit of fiddliness there. So before you start Googling if there's printing errors, no, we didn't find anything like
thankfully
that.
Thankfully, there's a hint book to check your answers against. But yes, and overall, I found that answer matrix, it worked very smoothly. Yes. I mean, it was a hiccup on our part.
Yeah, overall, had a fantastic experience with Side Quest Nemesis, despite not having played the Nemesis game. As for a horror creepy game, did I feel any sense of terror, dread? Nah, not a lot. I think one of the events and one of the things that happened later in the game wasn't as much like a jump scare, but like definitely had the, ooh, that's creepy. I'm glad I'm not in that situation. And there was some, what you did get though is that feeling of exploring an empty ship. Like they did manage to give that feeling of discovering things and exploring really well, perhaps better than other games, just by giving me a map to move around and letting me choose which way to go. And like we found something that we weren't sure what to do with, so we had to go back to it later, was just cool. Like you found this thing, but you don't know what it's for. So we left and like, oh, now we have this other thing, so we have to go back. Right. So you definitely get that feeling of exploration. I didn't feel scared. Maybe you get a little bit of a jump scare flipping over a card. Most of it was just puzzles. Definitely without a timer. That's the one part you lose by not having that timer. Where we did have a timer of our podcast, we were going to go live at 8 p.m. But without that timer, there wasn't that sense of urgency that I think would have actually made this a little better for what it was.
Yeah, the sense of exploration was really strong, and I liked it. It was non-linear. It was not. We chose where to go on the map. And we even had to circle back and stuff. And we chose which rooms to go to. And that just felt cooler than going from A to B to page C and continue onward, right? Yep. So that was neat. And personally, I did feel that there was a little bit, just a little bit of that tension and a feeling of dread because there's aliens and bad things can happen. So there was just a little bit of that feeling of dread. There's those bad events that happen each round. Mm-hmm. And you know, if you fail them, bad things happen. We managed to succeed on most of them, but like that did, I felt tense about, oh, I better get these ones. These That's puzzles true. Matter. We better get these ones right, because if we don't, bad things happen. And you only have one shot at getting this answer. Whereas the other ones were like, we got time to sit here and figure out this circuit board or switch panel or whatever. But no, when you're like, okay, you're encountering an alien, you got one shot at the answer, and you better not screw it up. So there was that tension there. I like that.
Yeah, actually, I will change my final answer there to say, yeah, no, you definitely had it with the cards where there was a right or wrong, and there were consequences if you were right or wrong. Mm-hmm. Definitely did give you that. We don't want to be wrong. Like, I don't want to mess this up. I definitely had that feel. And then there was a neat bit of tension at the end, but I think if I explain that one, nope. I am going to spoil it. So we're going to stop here, and I think that's all we're going to say. I will say, fans of escape room games, pick this up. Fans of murder mysteries, no, that's not what this is. This is not a deduct the clues. This is a puzzle game. This is an escape room in a box. You are physically manipulating things. You're using logic. You're making connections. You're doing all the things you do in an escape room. Fans of Nemesis, I think, should check this out, because I think it's a really cool way to explore a universe you love in a new way. Possibly not for little kids, not for big groups.
I give this a 10 out of 10. Highly recommend. Go grab it.
Number rating.
Wow. Number rating. That's something we don't do. All right. Well, now, are you a fan of the Side Quest games? Are you a fan of the Nemesis games? Are there other games in either one of these series that we should be trying out? Let us know on social medias. Hop into anywhere you see Tabletop Bellhop, or jump over to our Discord at tabletopbellhop.com/discord. Discord.tabletopbellhop.com. That's right. We have that one that works.
We might have both. I don't even know, actually.
Let's try that again. Are you a fan of the Side Quest series? Are you a fan of the Nemesis series? Are there any more in either one of these series that we should try out? Let us know on social media. We can be found everywhere as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, or join us in our Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com to let us know what we should try out next from one of these series.
Now, the one thing this game did make me want to do is we also have the 7C one. I am really looking forward to diving into that one. Pun intended. But the other thing is, this comes from a group that made the Escape Tales series. So one of the things I will be doing when we are done this episode is Googling Escape Tales to find out what other games are there, because if it's anything like half as good as this, I want to know.
As wedding planners, you show up to the reception early only to see a total disaster. You are going to have to figure out what happened, whose fault it is, and save the night.
The Marriage Mix-Up is Game 9 in the Holiday Hijinks series of games from Grand Gamers Guild, who not only provided us with a review copy of this escape room game, but are also a sponsor of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
This 18-card puzzle game is the first in the series to require at least two players. If playing with more than two, you're going to have to break up into teams, though you don't have to tell anyone that until you start playing.
This clever puzzle comes from the mind of Jonathan Schaefer, who continues to blow us away with the variety he's managed to get into these games. This mystery game takes about an hour to play and does require the use of a web-based app.
Like all games in the Holiday Hijinks series, you start by opening up the card pack, placing the deck face down on the table, scanning a QR code inside the package or heading to a specific website, and selecting the appropriate game, which of course is the Marriage Mix-Up in this case. The app will point out how the game works and have you flip over the first card in the deck, which is card A1.
Each card or set of cards that you reveal will present a puzzle and a question that you need to answer by solving that puzzle. Once you have that answer, someone will enter it into the app, which will continue the story and tell you what new card to reveal. You keep on solving puzzles and revealing cards until you get to the final solution. At that point, you're presented with a score and the ability to submit that to the designer and publisher.
If you ever get stuck, there is a graduated hint system built right into the web app, which also provides some additional information so you don't need any outside resources to solve the puzzles. For the Marriage Mix-Up, this includes a list of wedding traditions from around the world and standard number letter substitution cipher.
The puzzles here are a mix of logic, deduction, riddle, and word games, and there are some which you'll need a scrap piece of paper for, and there was one where we wanted to write on the card. So our pro tip for all of the Holiday Hijinks games is just keep a set of card sleeves available and some wet erase markers, because that worked out great for this particular puzzle. By doing this, you won't mess up any of the cards, and you can pass the game on to someone else when you're finished, which is a great bonus for the series of games.
The neatest part of the marriage mix-up is that it forces you to split into two groups very early in the game, right after the first puzzle. For the majority of the game, you're going to be working in two groups, and each group will be presented with their own questions and puzzles. This doesn't mean you're off working on your own. This marriage-themed game is all about communication. Groups are going to have to work together and communicate with each other in order to solve any of the puzzles.
A key here is not to cheat. The game tells you that you cannot show the other team your cards, and you should listen to that. The reason being that if one group or person has had access to both sets of clues, the answers would be far too easy to achieve.
Yeah.
The fun of this particular escape room game is that limited communication and having to work together.
Which I think perfectly fits the theme here. Now, our play took us 43 minutes, and we got a score of 5 out of 5. One puzzle stumped us for a while, but most we found pretty easy. All the puzzles were very clear on what you had to do, and it was fun trying to figure out what information needed to be communicated to the other team, and then the best way to actually do that communication, what to say and how to get the right answers out of people.
Yeah, I really enjoyed watching you play this with our youngest kid. Like, your body language, you were leaning in towards each other. You were animatedly talking. I could see how engaged you were. I could tell how much you were enjoying yourselves, but also just how much collaboration was required.
Now, one thing that did stick out in this one, though, was how often we were able to deduce the final answer without fully solving the entire puzzles. So you're trying to look for answers to type into an app. So they're all words, right? So we get like two or three letters and you're doing a wedding thing. So this is not one of the clues in the game, say, but you would have like R-I and it's a four letter word and you're at a wedding and you're like, I wonder what it could be, right? So I will say this is a big part of what has helped us finish in under an hour. We were able to accurately deduce full answers without fully solving some of the problems.
So you were cheating and just guessing is what you're saying.
I would say that if we got any wrong, but the fact that we got every single one of them right in that case. Now, I will admit there was one where Genevieve's like, put this in. And then she's like, oh, wait, no, it can't be that because that's too long. So it's got to be this. So that did come up. But no, we did not put in any wrong answers.
This is one of those games where, although Jonathan Schaefer is doing amazing things here and really thinking outside the box and making you, you know, really working to find all these new solutions for 18 card games, it is still an 18 card game. And there is going to be some familiarity because the designer is contiguous across all the Holiday Hijinks games. There is a little bit of getting to know your designer involved in these games as well.
Now, the one thing I thought of when this game was announced, when Mark, our sponsor, told us this was, he gave us a little heads up. Here's what's coming is a new Easter game and a wedding game. I'm like, ooh, a wedding game. That'd be so awesome. You have them on your table at your wedding and have your guests play. And I thought that would be really cool. But I got to say, it could work. Yes. But I don't think it'd be ideal. Like tying up your wedding guests for an hour and forcing people into groups may not go over well. Where I think this would be better, if I was going to have a wedding and have this here, I would have it be the wedding favor that each couple would take home. And that way they can play it together after the fact.
Yeah, as a take home gift, this could be really neat. Or maybe something to do at a bridal shower or stag and doe.
Okay, yeah.
Yes. But it's something to do at the wedding, even a gamer wedding. I'm thinking no.
Yeah, that's a big hunk of time for a wedding. But I could definitely see a stag and doe game. This would work out very well.
Yeah, and I got to say, if you're going to do something like that, I would be like first people to finish. Hmm. Or maybe highest score, because then you'd cheat and just look up the answers. Highest score? I don't know. I don't know what you'd have to do. Anyway, overall, I continue to be very impressed by this entire line of Holiday Hijinks games. Yes, I know Mark's a sponsor, but we've been in love with these games long before he sponsored our show. We've enjoyed every single one of the Holiday Hijinks games, and I'm looking forward to exploring more. These new games... There are three new games in the series actually up on Kickstarter right now while we're recording this, and that's already funded. So there are now a total of 12 Holiday Hijinks games that are going to be out there for people, which I think is kind of cool. What I liked most about this one, though, was that team aspect, that whole split into groups. In the story, you're separated by a divider, and you're supposed to be yelling through the divider. And I'd be like really tempted that if I was hosting a game night, I would put something physically up between the two groups and have them like yell through answers to each other. I think that'd be awesome. I love the way you couldn't possibly solve these puzzles without the help of the other group. And that was something new for the series. And I loved how it fit in with the theme.
Yeah, again, I was pleasantly surprised at how the designer, Jonathan Schaefer, manages to bring some new twist to each of these tiny 18-card escape room games. It's super clever stuff. It makes me excited to try the next one. The Valentine's Day one was also recommended for two to play, and it broke it up so that you could each be solving puzzles independently. Yes. So when they said, oh, this is a game for two, I really expected that, not for two to have to work together. And I just thought that was such a cool twist.
Now, at this point, with the new Kickstarter, I encourage any puzzle, mystery, escape room in a box fan to pick up the entire series. Like, just grab them all. They're worth it. And for those of you who already have some of the games, I think you're going to really dig the marriage mix-up. Like, keep picking them up. I also think it's a good entry point. Yes, this is number 9, but they don't have to be played in order. They're completely unrelated to each other, except for they're all 18 cards and all by the same designer. Doesn't mean you can't start here. I think this would be actually like a kind of cool way to get people into the series.
And yeah, this is one of the easier ones, right? I think the box says 2-star difficulty, yeah. And you had mentioned you thought that was accurate, or maybe this was even just a 1-star, which I think does make it a great start point for the series.
Well, that's it for our look at Holiday Hijinks number 9, The Marriage Mix-Up. Be sure to check out our reviews of the other games in the series. At this point, we've played all but one of them and have enjoyed them all. But each game is unique, and some will appeal to some groups more than others.
Now, have you played any of these games? Because I want to know, what's your favorite Holiday Hijinks game? If you haven't tried these games in particular, how about share with us your favorite escape room in a box style game? We're always looking for more games to play with our family.
Well, that was the double bell.
That means our shift's coming to an end, and we're going to have to lock the lobby doors.
Before we start locking things down, let's take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons. Derek Kissen, thank you, Derek.
Hey, folks over at the Misdirected Mark, thank you for your support.
Donna, thanks, Pax.
Thank you, Evil John.
Mr. Kurtz, one of our many Bryans, thank you for being the first.
Chris Leary, thank you.
I want to jump in among
Brian's.
I want to jump in here and say an extra special thank you to Chris Leary for actually sending us feedback on our new format. It was super appreciated.
Well, your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but you can find us all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Once again, the single thing we would love most in the universe is a review. If you enjoyed the show, please head over to Spotify, Pandora, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you're listening. Leave us a review and help other people find the show.
And if you dig the content we create, you can show your support through our Patreon, becoming one of our patrons, where you do get some cool bonus stuff, or over at Ko-fi, which is ko-fi.com. Just head over there and search Tabletop Bellhop on either platform. That's all for us tonight.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And
game on.